Look, we don't talk about transportation much here, but I thought this was the appropriate time to actually have some conversation about maybe the most important transportation project in a generation here for us. We haven't talked much about it because there hasn't been much to do because we didn't have any money. But now, in response to some state legislation, we actually have money. And it's been a long time, it's been years since we've talked about this. So let me line up who the players are here, and then, you know, you guys can interrupt at any time. But the city of Norfolk, I represent the city on a couple of different transportation organizations, one of which is called the Hampton Roads Transportation Planning Organization. That's not to be confused any longer with a group called the Hampton Roads Metropolitan Planning Organization, which went away. We changed the name because it was a transportation commission. So the MPO is now the TPO. Some other places like even in Northern Virginia, Richmond, they're following are the regional lead here to identify the organization for what it is. The TPO is that organization which is charged by the federal government with coming up with what's called the constrained long-range transportation plan for the region. In other words, we have to put together a long-range plan. It has to be financially constrained and also has to meet certain air quality standards. It's called the TPO. In order to access money from the federal government to build these major projects, it has to be in the TPO plan. On the TPO board sit all of the localities, representatives from all the localities in Hampton Roads, but also you know, people like the Federal Highway Administration, the transit authorities sit there and have votes. So it is a fairly comprehensive group, and it does the planning for what should a regional network look like, and it prioritizes these projects. It has the data, it does the studies, it has the professionals and the engineers and the consultants who make recommendations to the region about what plan should be included. Okay, so that is the federal agency. Along comes something called this Hampton Roads Transportation Accountability Commission. That is a creature of state government, not to be confused with the TPO, even though they work very closely together now. The state government piece, the HRTAC, actually has money to spend. That is in line with a state increased state funding for transportation that was statewide, but also it created a couple regional pots of money. Down here, the region collectively is gathering $15,000 or $16,000 a month to spend. City of Norfolk is the third largest donor, just behind Chesapeake in that plan. So we have a lot of skin in this game, in the pot. The HRTAC, which also has all the cities in Hampton Roads on it, but it has General Assembly members, since it is a voting member, since it is a, like I said, a state piece, a state, and there are 5 members of the General Assembly, there are 14 localities. Only the mayor, according to the state legislation, can vote, as well as the General Assembly members out there. There are a lot of other voting issues, but the HTAC has its own money, and it can leverage federal money if it adopts the plan that the TPO has presented, okay? And that's basically what has happened out there. The HTAC money is just for larger, significant projects that are at least of $100 million or more, okay? So we've decided not, unlike some regions, I mean, in Northern Virginia, some of the localities get a few of the bucks. We're just gonna commit all these projects, all this money to big projects. When you roll all this money together, Dwight Farmer, the former director of the TPO, thought we could build leverage with state and federal money as much as $10 billion in spending. It may not be true right now. We may not get to that, but certainly it's maybe $8 or $9 billion. And that's without toll money. So, all right, so what does that mean to us? Since early in the 1990s, 92, 93, 94, the region began a study about how could we relieve traffic at the Hampton Roads Bridge Dome. OK, Okay. What's the, but it wasn't just, you know, maybe we should build another tube. The question was, how do you do it in the smartest way possible? How do you do it in a way that is not only cost-effective, but how do you do it in a way that provides the most congestion relief, that supports the economy, that does less violence to the environment, that actually gets people where they want to go? How do you do it in relative ease of implementation? If you try to build more tubes at the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel while you're using it, and everything, you know, if you shut down lanes, it means, well, none of us would survive that. So I'm going to come back to this in a minute, but you know, we've taken the position here, at least the city has for years, that the Patriots Crossing, which is the first phase of something you've heard about called the Third Crossing, is the project we want built next in this region, and we have to join hands and try to make sure the rest of the region understands that. And this is a little quote that I think Jeff came up with, but I agree with. Since 1997, we began the study in 93, 94. In 1997, the TPO actually adopted this the third crossing as the region's unanimously agreed upon an official priority for additional harbor crossing capacity in Hampton Roads, and the decision has been revalidated and endorsed by the regions any number of times since 1997. Since 1997, this has been the region's project. The reason that, you know, I've got this up here is that from time to time over the years, as representatives at the TPO change, as General Assembly members come and go, as different people come in from different transit authorities, every couple of years somebody says, well, why don't we just widen the bridge tunnel? Because they've lost sight of the fact of what we are trying to do with the Patriots Crossing. They say, well, that's where the congestion is. Why don't we just do that? And we go back and say, wait a minute, we studied this thing years ago. We all agreed unanimously this was the way to go. And so that's what we continue to fight for, to build this project. So go ahead now, fill in the blanks and go quickly here. Luce, are you doing this? Are you gonna? Okay. Thank you. Here is the transportation plan that I talked to you about that the TPO has in it, the Transportation Planning Organization. There are basically nine different projects in it, one of which is the widening of 64 that you've heard about. You know, here is the third crossing with the Craney Island Connector. Here is the second phase of the third crossing out here. Here is the congestion. Here is the piece that we talk about as far as what all the backup that occurs at 264 and 64. There's the high-rise bridge in this project. There's a roadway out here. There's 58, 13, connector. There are basically nine projects in here, the total of which, the spending of which would be $8.7 billion. We could actually afford to do that if we decided to go out and do that. Okay, so that's the TPO plan. Here's the number and that number may go up a little bit as the numbers get refined. Out of the TPO, we've agreed already to do all of this, and that's about $600 million piece to widen the peninsula. Everybody agrees you got to do that. The other project that was shovel ready was this interchange here of about $310 million. We've agreed to proceed on that. These other projects, the third crossing, there you see the Patriots Crossing, is a $6 billion effort. And that's the reason it's got the bullseye on it. And then you come down here, you've got $1.7 billion for the high-rise bridge. And I think that's going to get a lot more expensive than that. This number over here tells you how much is really coming out of this Hampton Roads Transportation Fund, which is the fund I talked about earlier on that we're all contributing now, which the city of Norfolk, you know, is nearly the second largest contributor. The beach is the largest. But if you bond all that, that's how much money you can get. Okay. Here is the Patriots Crossing, the third crossing. The third crossing is a six-phase, 20-year construction plan that includes two phases, the so-called Patriots Crossing, and then this piece here, which runs from 460, it's a limited access roadway, all the way up, adds two tubes to the modern Merrimack, goes up in a limited access roadway all the way up here to 64. This is the bridge tunnel that comes through here. So the goal is to divert traffic away from the bridge tunnel down into another corridor that will carry the traffic over here, up the Monitor to Merrimack, and back up to 64. And this is the Craney Island connector, which also increases the connectivity for people who are trying to get out here. This really adds a lot of connectivity. So what we're trying to do right now is get the first phase, the Patriots Crossing, done.
Okay. And how is that broken up, Paul, in expenses?
This is a $2.5 billion project.
Okay.
And this is $500 million down here. That project may get a little more expensive. I met with the Secretary of Transportation Friday, and he thinks the number, as far as he knows, it's not going to go off the graph like I was afraid, but it's still a pretty good number. $2.5 million, it may go up a couple hundred million, but nobody's fighting over that any longer. I mean, this is the important thing about this is that it leaves Norfolk just north of NIT, where the new gates are being built, the 22 new gates with that federal grant that the Vice President came down here to talk about, and just south of the naval base. The Navy and the port will have direct access to the Patriots Crossing. They have gates that really move right from their land right onto the Patriots Crossing. That happens in one of the earlier phases of that, which we can talk about in a second, but basically, just to outline it for you, it goes over here to the Monitor to Merrimack, and then goes through the Monitor to Merrimack on up to 64, and it comes down to Craney Island here. And it permits the travel of containers over to the AP Moeller site, over to the Craney Island connector, the Craney Island piece, which we think by 2034, I think, is the year that all this will actually be needed. So this is, from here to there, is a multi-year project, as is this, but you got to get started, okay? Now, everybody follow me here? You know what this does, okay? The Patriots Crossing diverts traffic from the bridge tunnel. There are about 90,000 cars a day here. Monitor Merrimack has about 62 or 63,000 cars. If we can move 8, 10, 12,000 cars a day away from the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel, push them through here, there's some unused capacity in the Monitor Merrimack. So we want to build this before we build any more harbor crossing capacity until we've used it all. So that's why this is the first phase. This also is the one project that takes the containers off the Hampton Roads, off of Hampton Boulevard. There will be no need for containers on Hampton Boulevard once this is built. Okay, so it relieves congestion for us at the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel, takes containers off of Hampton Boulevard, supports our main economic drivers of the military and also of the port. It also relieves congestion, the study says, at the downtown tunnel, the midtown tunnel as well, and actually out at the high-rise bridge. But we are really, for us, it relieves pressure at the bridge tunnel, the midtown, and the downtown tunnels. Okay.
Paul, the I-64 wide is out the bid right now.
Yes, I mean, we have the money. Yeah, we have pushed that forward. Otherwise, you can do all of this, but all you do is get to the back of the line faster.
What I'm saying is that's out the bid. It's kind of a design build type.
Yep, because we're trying to rush it.
When do we realistically think that maybe the Patriots Crossing would go into that design build? I mean, there's two or three firms looking at it. They'll come to the state with their proposal.
You know, what the thing that will make the difference here is how the Army Corps of Engineers and the federal government treat the environmental impact statement, okay? This thing has already, many, many years ago, I can show you the timeline, received what's called a ROD, Record of Decision, from the federal government many, many years ago. But it's got so much age on it, they may take the position that they have to do a whole new environmental impact statement. That's typically a 3-year process. We think they can do a supplement, which is about a 12 to 18 months. So this could be construction, could be a couple years out if we're really lucky.
From
you
now?
Know? Yeah.
Because, I mean, the 64 wide, and it'll probably go right?
Yeah, and this is at least 5 years of construction.
Right, I understand, but they're going to start on 64 wide, and Admitting it now, design bill.
Right. That's me, by the way. I mean, by the time you would actually get to design money, construction money, Jeff, 2 years is probably pushing it, right? Yeah. Because you got to get the EIS statement, and then you've got to do the design and construction documents, and then you've got to go forward. And caught up in all of this is something called tolls, which we don't have enough time to talk about tonight. But this is the
fundamentals. They have to, VDOT or whomever has to provide the hard bid documents for that as opposed to what they're doing in 64, which is large firms coming in with the design.
I think so. Unless you were to get some sort of private proposal that might move forward here, which they could.
What do you mean caught up in this is tolls?
The question about whether or not you should do congestion pricing here at the bridge tunnel, or whether or not you should toll the third crossing here, the Patriots crossing, since you have tolls at the Midtown and Downtown tunnel. The question is a traffic management issue as much as it is a revenue issue.
And I'm totally in support, obviously, of this, but the question was with the Midtown and the tolling and the profit that private concern needed to make, that if the traffic is lessened at the Midtown, that would drive the tolls up. Is that still something we're working at or anticipating?
That's another one of those really questions thing. Because they're entitled, I mean, they expect a certain amount of traffic down here at the Midtown tunnel.
Right.
And if we do something that would take traffic away from that, then there's a clause in the contract that says they should be compensated for the amount of revenue that they anticipated when they, agreed to this contract. It's an awful, awful, awful contract. They actually put limitations on every water crossing, including the high-rise bridge. That's what the state said. But, there are a lot of questions about what will happen in the future with the Midtown Tunnel contract and, what the value of that is. And once the new tunnel gets opened and how much revenue they're collecting, and once we find out how much revenue they're collecting, you can actually quantify what the project is worth. And maybe there's a way to either buy the toll down or get rid of that clause, or maybe just buy the whole ERC, the project itself.
Right. Just felt that if we want to garner support from all the players on this, then, we need to be looking long range, because obviously folks like Portsmouth are going to have a huge impact if that changes the tolling on the Midtown.
Everybody wants the Midtown tunnel tolls to be moderated.
I know.
For sure. I mean, that's everybody.
I don't want them to interpret this as jeopardizing the moderation of those tolls.
They don't. Okay. In fact, they voted for this. This means more to them. This means all of this stuff happens over here in Portsmouth, which ensures the development of Craney Island here. I mean, I think it helps.
Have we ever looked at who is it that's congesting the HRBT? Where do those folks come from? Are they military? Are they?
We got all of that.
I mean, do we know the percentage?
Yeah, we can tell you what cities they come from. I mean, it's.
I just wanted to see if for sure we're going to still attract those people to the Patriots Crossing, as opposed to think them looking at it and saying it's still going to be closer for me to do HRBT.
The traffic, we're so deficient in crossing, it carries everything. Military, shopping, school, long distance, what have you. But in terms of the military, when you come through the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel and hit Willoughby, you're about 7 or 8 miles away from the main gate at Norfolk Naval Station, Gate 2. Coming now through the Patriots Crossing, when you arrive in Norfolk, you're at the base. You're taking that whole leg out of the trip.
Right, so if you're coming from Hampton and you're going to go down through Montemeromack and over, what's the savings in miles if you're going to the naval base?
There will be both savings in miles and time.
And is 10% of the traffic military?
At various times.
Well, I'm talking about the congestion time. That's what we care about.
It's congested all day long almost. I mean, this is one of the largest choke points. It is the largest choke point in the whole region. All we're talking about moving is about 10 or 12% of the traffic away. We're not trying to get every one of these guys over here. But we're confident that, and all the studies have demonstrated, in fact, V-Mask, and I'll get to that in a second, did the Old Dominion Virginia Modeling and Simulation, concluded that this one project would do more to relieve congestion in the entire region than any other project we could build.
I think it'll reduce frustration levels, because there's nothing more frustrating than sitting on the bridge, tunnel, bridge, on the bridge, waiting
this,
to go.
This will give you an alternative.
I don't show traffic. I don't show houses after 3 o'clock if I've got to go to Hampton.
Yes.
Unless it's on a Saturday or Sunday. I just don't go over there because it's awful.
Yep. Hey, now, okay. Now, how do we, the study started in 93, 94. This is language that we lifted out of the study. It said, you know, here's the criteria for figuring out how we should cross the water. What can we do to reduce volumes at the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel by 10% or more? How do we address existing and future regional travel where people are really trying to get? And you know, how do we connect our major, you know, economic drivers, the ports, the military, and the major freight corridors together? How do we connect to controlled access highways? The cost, and I'll go through that in a second, and then the relative ease of implementation. Okay. So we looked at 11 different alternatives. And everything from expanding the bridge tunnel to other tunnels in other areas of the region. And the conclusion was to build the third crossing. And that was the unanimous. It was selection alternative number 9. And that's what we agreed upon in 97. And the reasons we did that are as valid today, okay, as they were when we did it. And this, in fact, back then we called the third crossing, the whole thing was called the third crossing. And that was part of the problem, because it is such a massive project that you can't just call it one road project. And that's what the region called it. So other people had other things they wanted to get done, but this was going to soak up all the money, so this became the thing that everybody shot at. Okay. There's been constant support of this as recently as this past October. I mean, a year ago, and in fact, just 2 or 3 weeks ago. Okay. The people who have endorsed this include the Transportation Board, the Port Authority, the Maritime Association, the Old Hampton Roads Partnership, other cities, the U.S. Navy, the Norfolk Southern, Transit. Actually, you could say the federal guys endorsed it because they issued a record of decision as well. I mean, they approved it. Okay. And here's a timeline. And we have a lot of different things that occurred over time. But here is the 2001, the federal government said, we agree that this is what you should build. And that's the record of decision is very hard to get. But it, as you see, it happened in 2001, and so it's gathered a lot of dust. Okay. There have been other resolutions supporting this. The biggest, this one down here, in the General Assembly, because they started questioning the science behind should we do the third crossing or expand the bridge tunnel, asked Virginia Modeling and Simulation Center at Old Dominion to study what we should do. And they studied it. And they came out with their solution. And it is, and their conclusion is that if you would build the Patriots Crossing, you would do more to relieve congestion, not just at the bridge tunnel, but the entire region. And so people were just dumbfounded that they agreed with everything that the region had been saying since 97. So the other thing that happened is that the state did a study for environmental impact purposes of the expansion of the bridge tunnel. We'll get to that in a second. And we will, you know, and there are other things. And this past year, in July, June, actually, Molly Ward, the mayor of Hampton, drafted a resolution reaffirming the third crossing endorsement because she was concerned about the environmental damage to Hampton. Then we came through later on in October of 2013, voted again because we had to get this into our so-called long-range plan. And then we did it again just the other day, unanimously. There's always a lot of discussion, but at the end of the day, they all vote unanimously, okay, for this thing. And here's the numbers that I talked about. 90,000 cars at the bridge tunnel, 63 at the Monitor Merrimack. If you can move some of this traffic over here, you're both still at capacity, but you will flow relatively freely. Okay. Now, here's the other thing we learned while we were having this discussion about the HRBT. This is important, okay? That if you do the Patriots Crossing, you may have to relocate 16 properties. At the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel, these are VDOT numbers. The number becomes 275. There's one business relocation. There's 16 here at the Bridge Tunnel. There are 26 properties here that have increased noise. At the Bridge Tunnel, if you expand that, there's almost 1,000. There are recreation facilities impacted if you expand the Bridge Tunnel. 13, there are none for the Patriots Crossing. There are 13 historic sites, including the Veterans Cemetery in Hampton. Wetlands, only 35 here, but 50 at the Bridge Tunnel. The federal highway guys, in my opinion, will never let that happen when there's an easier way to do it, a better way, a smarter way to do it over here. You know, and the federal highway administrator, the guy who sits on the TPO with me, caught me at the door at the last time we had that vote and said, you know, these numbers, he was prepared to start talking about it before we voted, but I don't think they'll ever let that happen. Okay. So the Patriots Crossing gives the region, if you do it, the most improvement in regional travel time. It supports our economy. It accommodates future growth in the region. It does less environmental damage to the natural environment and to the built environment. The other thing about the ease of construction, I mentioned that early on, is that imagine trying to build two new tunnels at the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel while you're still using it and the backups that will occur. At the Patriots Crossing, you're creating a whole new corridor, so you don't have to worry about any of that. You don't have to worry about any of that. So you can build this thing while you're still using the bridge tunnel. You can use this, and then the bridge tunnel is 60 years old. It desperately needs a renovation over there. Its life expectancy right now is zero. Okay, was that the last? Can you flip around to the very first section again, the first map there of the whole third crossing? The other good thing that's happening is, one more, is that this is the six-segment project, right? This project right here is called, in shorthand, it's called the Intermodal Connector. This is going to be, this is being built. It will start next month, Jeff?
It's a design build, so construction.
I mean, this year, it will, they originally told me October, so I'm going to say November. But there is about, is this $165 million?
$178,
okay. Called me a liar for 13 years.
Again, these things grow.
I know, but it has to do with some right-of-ways and stuff here. This is being built right now. This is what the NIT will connect to, which with those new gates, which will actually, that should take some containers off Hampton Boulevard as well. This will allow for a new gate here into the naval base, which will ease some of the congestion of some of the other gates, including, you know, down at Hampton Boulevard, maybe.
So they're not coming down Terminal. This is going to be a whole new road.
They'll be coming down Terminal, and then they're, go ahead, Jeff.
It comes off 564 just south of corridor.
Right, so Terminal will no longer be a major road then for it to be used by trucks.
Oh,
right now,
no, it still will be, yeah. but you'll south have this too.
It can go south, okay.
South gate. North and south gates will have its own, right?
So we still do have to improve Terminal then?
Well, the state is going to pay for the most of that now.
Okay.
They have changed their terminal.
Okay.
Okay.
Because I heard that
but,
was an expensive
but this,
project.
And this is not included in the $3 billion cost here. So that's already getting help. That's about a two-year construction project. So the first phase to actually bring the traffic down to the waterfront is already occurring. So any other questions about this? I've been going out to business groups and talking about it. The Hampton Roads Chamber of Commerce asked me to come speak. Greater Norfolk Corporation, the so-called business roundtable. I've got some other groups to speak to, because every time we all agree that we should do the Patriots Crossing, somebody will say, well, what about the bridge tunnel? And so we have to keep fighting.
We
got everybody lined up right now.
And be the point of no return, because like you say, three elections and something changes, and here we go again.
We're as close as we've ever been, Markley, because we now have the money. We have a secretary and a governor who I think believe in this. And we have a unanimous vote at the TPO and at the HRTAC. And to reverse a unanimous vote out there now is very hard, as long as we're in league with a couple of other Band cities. Well, I mean, we've got to get the price. We've got to get the environmental impact statement updated. And then we'll be off and running.
Two things. Did we do a resolution already making this?
Many years ago, we did a resolution.
Yeah, because we were listed there as City of Norfolk.
Yeah, I missed it.
That was in 97 that we did a resolution.
Okay, do we need to do an updated one?
That was third grade for you, Tom.
Yes. Actually, I just graduated high school.
We had a little criminal. we could. But, I mean, the point is that when you're in the community, this is something, this saves Willoughby. I've told the people out of the TPO, not one more foot of Willoughby are we going to surrender for the region. I mean, we should not have to. And also, you know, Hampton Boulevard gets a huge boost by the containers coming off of it. But that's not the main reason. The main reason is because of the regional importance of this project.
Paul, I had the pleasure of speaking to the Norfolk Tea Party, and there were some of their members that were not in favor of the third crossing. And I explained why. Particularly because of the amount of houses that could be taken in Willoughby and along Ocean View. But they said that they have new information that said that they're going to use interior lanes, not exterior lanes. And I said, well, that has never been presented to us, but that our big concern was the amount of, I think it was 280-something houses just in Willoughby alone, properties.
Well, some of those are in Hampton, some are over here. But if you... what happens here, and VDOT has studied this, by the way, you can't expand the bridge tunnel with just one tunnel. You need two tunnels. You can't have reverse lanes, for instance. We all thought you could build one tunnel in here. Because of the engineering and what happens as you try to get into the tunnel, and over here as you get into it, VDOT concluded you could not build just one tunnel. Okay? You couldn't do a hot lane in there. I mean, I know some people still think you could. So they said you have to do two tunnels, one headed east and one headed west. Like, well, that made the project $8 billion. That ate up all the money. This down here, of course, like I said, is three, and that's three, but it's $8 billion, because you got to do two, and this is VDOT's own, you know, General Assembly asked them to study how you could do this, and they concluded you couldn't do it. The only thing you could do was do two tubes. Now, some people say that, you know, maybe VDOT could be talked out of their conclusion, but you'd have to demonstrate that. I don't think you could. The Tea Party guys say just build one tunnel and you do it within the existing road bed, not within the right-of-way, but within the road bed.
Right.
And I don't think, and they studied that and concluded you could not do that.
Right.
If you try to take any more of Willoughby, you're in the people's backyards.
Sure.
I mean, you literally, in every one of these 270 homes now, because of the eminent domain laws and the new condemnation laws, there's a lawsuit. For every property there'll be a lawsuit, you can bet. Especially when they, every one of those properties will expect to be compensated. And it'll tie up, of course, things for years and years and years. Jeff, you started.
No, it's just everything you're saying, going back to the EIS, I pulled out the earlier work that we've done back in December of 2012. That kind of six-lane option, you know, was rejected. If you're not going to build Patriots, you need at least eight lanes at HRBT for the future. So to hold out that there's this median-only non-displaced was one of the options looked at and rejected in the study as being inadequate. So once you say we put all the eggs in one basket, it's going to be eight or ten lanes, and that's where you get into these massive impacts.
The other thing that happens here is this actually gives you another route out. If a truck turns over back here, you know, I mean, I don't care how many tunnels you have. If the approaches get stopped, you know, if you don't have, then the whole thing shuts down. So you need an alternative. I mean, it's just, why would you expand that when there's a cheaper, better, for every, you know, less environmental damage, I mean, everything, you know, more connectivity, supports your economy, does everything we talked about. Why would you do that?
Because of the concerns of evacuation and emergencies, especially with the naval presence. I mean, how much leverage are we getting from the Navy or the Feds? Because they're really driving a great deal of this necessity. Are they supporting this, you know, the Navy or recognizing?
The third crossing?
Yeah.
Yes.
And what about the VIT? Are they part of your list of supporters?
The port?
Yeah.
The port is always, this actually was conceived.
So they're
by
part
the
of those supporters. They're going
yes.
out campaigning.
No question.
Then just one last question. You're not going to like this, but what about light rail and yeah. rail?
Why
don't they ever consider that?
I mean, and I do like that, by the way.
Yeah.
Look, the original vision for light rail was that one day you would get on a light rail car in Williamsburg and come down the long, slender peninsula, you know, down something called the CSX corridor, that you would come out, that you could design a tube in the Monitor Merrimack, and then under the harbor and back over here and pop up in Norfolk. And then you could come out this way and go around to 64 and out to the beach, or maybe you could drop down to downtown and come around and go out to the beach. The idea was to connect the region between Williamsburg and Virginia Beach with Norfolk in the middle with a light rail system. And you can do that. I mean, you know, and you can engineer a tube in the third crossing here that will permit that. You cannot do that here. You eliminate the at least for several lifetimes, the ability to have a transit operation between the peninsula and the south side if you pursue a widening of the bridge tunnel. But here it is absolutely doable. The only question are money and the will. I mean, we could have done it 20 years ago. Sure.
We could have done it in 97. Us making long-range plans and being short-sighted.
Well, this includes the transit piece. Yeah. And the people on the peninsula, especially Mayor Price and Newport News, is probably is finally getting it, that this is the transit option to them.
How could you do light rail through HRBT, not expanding the tunnel, but just run one new tube with light rail?
Because you couldn't get the bridge, you won't get the light rail to the tunnel hardly.
Okay.
You know, I mean, so there just isn't enough land. Yeah, it just didn't, I mean, for one reason.
And at VML, that was one of our questions as far as some of our neighbors wanting to know about the Patriots crossing, because they're really interested in what is going to be happening and how it connects to their part of Virginia as well.
And the other piece about transit, trying to get it up the 64 corridor, there's no room in there any longer, right, Jeff?
Well, and if you're thinking about in Norfolk, you know, we're going to be coming back in council next month probably with preliminary results out of the Naval Base Extension Study, you know, that we're working actively to get rail up to the Navy base there, not to Willoughby.
It's just the perfect
so this is where the connection will have to be,
right,
coming through Norfolk,
right,
to that corridor, however it develops through that next phase of light rail going north and Norfolk.
I've been voting on this thing since 1997. I voted in 97 on this thing. I was part of the study in 92. And I mean, it's just why we continue. Every time it's like Dracula, the bridge tunnel thing keeps popping back up. I don't know, Tommy, you were in grade school in 92.
Joke for you. You'd be voting on this for another 30 years as mayor,
right,
probably.
anyway, we ought to be. We shouldn't let our friends in other cities off the hook when we say this is what we need to do. This is the thing we need to push. Okay.
We tease you, Paul, but you really have put in the long hours and long
on
miles.
This project.
So we tease you about it, but really nobody else could have done it.
Right. Closer than we've ever been.